The journey of nutrition of Maharashtra, SRLM, is my own journey. 3 years ago, when the mission came, I was new. We went to a village, Palghar, where Parmesh was there and Lakshmi is also here. And when we interacted with one of the SHGs there, we realized that whatever interventions of livelihoods are happening, if they don't understand the importance of nutrition, there's no point in them making any money in their lives. And so began our journey to take them forward in this nutrition growth and in nutrition. So our journey is basically in three phases. You know, when we first, as I said previously also in my presentation, Dasha Sutri, which we follow in Maharashtra, health, nutrition, sanitation is the second, is the sixth sutra, which we already follow. So for us to graduate from SHG formation and livelihoods to emphasize on health and nutrition was not really very difficult, because already we were included, we had included in our agenda, and we were discussing about it. Only thing is that how to improve the health service access, make them understand what their entitlements are, and improve their coverage in health and maternal health and child care services. The second part which we did was when we started the program, that was when we went forward to understand what are the needs of the community. Like previously, Mr. Vijayan was here was saying that the needs of the community is more important rather than us pushing a program on them. So that is what we went and did, that what do you really need when you want to think about nutrition. We discussed the agenda in all the SHG VO meetings. We also emphasized on the behavioral change, because people don't in a village normally, I don't know, some people are arguing that two meal pattern in the day is good, what we used to do before, eating heavy breakfast and eating heavy dinner. But then whether that breakfast includes all the aspects of the food, the five or six components which we eat, whether that is there or no is important. So the behavior change is important. Then what are the nutrients which should be there in your food? So what is essentially there? The ENA, the hygiene part also, when you talk about sanitation. And also then, how do you improve your homestead food production? Wherever you are living, how do you improve on that? That was discussed with them. Dietary diversification was discussed. What are the five kinds of components which should be there in your food, which they probably didn't know? We also had thematic campaigns, cooking demonstrations, how they can make better food. Convergence was there with various departments. Health and Nutrition Mission is there. Reliance Foundation is there in Maharashtra. So that was the second phase. And now in the third phase, we are coming to this stage when we are making Nutri snacks. And I invite you to Mahalakshmi Saras, which will be having a Nutri Villa, which you will be really happy to know about. So the Dasha Sutra is a sixth sutra which we have. We imparted all these principles to the people that you have to incorporate nutrition into your daily life. Unless you don't understand this, it will not be impossible for you to improve your livelihood. We made the context local to people. So what is grown locally? Millets, if they are there, the local food. You find that the fair price shops normally try to propagate wheat and rice. But actually, it is the local food which should be more important. And people, especially the tribals, they have different types of, you know, millets, which they don't really use, and coarse grains. So we inculcated those habits. Collaborating with other sectors of the department, empowering women, facilitating the diversification. We have a dedicated team. What is a real thing which worked for us, that we have dedicated cluster team. We told them how to improve on their storage and preservation processes, expanded their market, especially for the vulnerable groups, that they can access markets with their local produce. And we have incorporated nutrition promotion in every aspect, even in the school, educating them with the new knowledge. So we are not a technical department, basically. So with the support of Lakshmi, who's there, I really acknowledge all with all gratitude and humility, that she guided me to use the Lancet 2013 methodology. And we have basically used this methodology to design our program, because we don't have any technical support. So whatever has been done in our department is solely what Lakshmi told me, then Nutrition Department, Rajmato Jijau, and Reliance Foundation. And this has magic has happened because the people also desired to do this. So we basically imparted three things in this. There were three-pronged strategy. One was the behavioral change, as I mentioned. Second was to develop the homestead food production, and third was access to delivery. So at their own level, we taught them, made them understand the importance of nutrition. So the approach basically is the most important in this, because whenever you have a program, unless you have a specific approach to go ahead, it doesn't make sense. So we have strengthened the whole platform, diversified the diet, everything, but we began with dedicated meetings with the community. That was the main thing which did. We told them what is the value and what is the importance of health and nutrition and sanitation in their lives by simple methodologies, because the community people only first, we had them trained as master trainers. So home visits were done to those who were pregnant perhaps and having a 1,000-day program over there, which was not a part of Maharashtra government, but because of the SERP model, which was their SERP model, we adapted that also, and the 1,000-day program was done as adolescent girls, SAM and MAM girls were targeted. Community nutri gardens, because everyone doesn't have land at their place, so we emphasize, and especially for people to know what is the community garden like, what are, how does a homestead nutrition garden there, we have to educate the people. So we had community nutri gardens made, we had nutrition field school, which is normally done by agriculture department, but the livelihood section in our own department, in our own SRLM, we conversed with them and we developed a nutrition field school model also, which had these practices there of how, what is the nutritional aspect in food to be there, how it can be done with the rice and other things which they are producing. So vegetable garden combined with agriculture is what we really propagated on their own bandh and all that. And then there were campaigns for awareness amongst the people, because awareness is one of the most important things. People are not even aware of what they should be eating. Traditionally, they may have been eating good food, but as of now, they have lost it in the history. So again, delving back into that, and also using the practices and tools for monitoring. So we have a simple methodology of routine Excel package in which we take the data, but data is taken by the community resource persons who have been trained by us. So that is also being done. So we have been able to track our progress because of that. We have dedicated cluster level people. So that is the trick in this whole thing, that we have a cadre of 1,115 people there, who are totally dedicated to this cause. Along with the nutrition, we have the livelihoods people also trained for this. So this dedicated approach helped us to make these kind of interventions which are there. These are basically such collective efforts. All over the state, we have more than 50,000. So this is a 7-step process. The first step was training the CTCs. There is a 5-day training, 3-day training, then establishment of Nutri Garden. Government of India support was very important. We have something known as stimulus fund, and they permitted us to use 2,000 rupees for this Nutri Garden, and that was a trick. A stimulus fund is a concept that when you borrow the money, you return it back to the community, but that was usually basically used for toilets. But I decided to use it for the community garden, and Government of India, we wrote a proposal, gave them, and they allowed us. So that was basically the main trick which helped me to create these Nutri Gardens in such large numbers. Support of the community agriculture manager, the CTCs is there. Then we also developed a Nutri Garden counseling book, which helped us to go ahead. Advisory was issued. And finally, the HB levels, which have been monitored, has not been monitored by us, but by the health department. So the outcomes are there for you to see, that almost 500 houses we tracked. The consumption of vegetables, I want to draw your attention to this, that the consumption of vegetables in every house has increased to 90%+. They also started growing a variety of vegetables. More than 90% of the people are growing vegetables, which are 5 varieties. They're also included 5 to 7 types of food among their diet. So that is also very important, that normally they were not eating such 5 varieties of food. They started doing that. The range of HB which we monitored is between 10 to 14, some places 10 to 12, some places 10 to 14. And all this record is available with us in our office, can be checked anytime. We are open to that. Last time also childcare was there. We had invited and requested them. So somebody could probably come and help us to analyze this. This is basically the 18 practices we all know that we try to emphasize on this. Essential nutrition action, health action, and then homestead food production. So there were some, these are the 12 indicators which we followed. Some challenges basically were that people don't have enough space to make these gardens. Water is also a problem. Also inculcating habits of 18 practices among the people. Why is it necessary? Why do we need to eat so many things? These were the types of the problems which were there amongst us, which we could not really, you know, we had to push people basically. They don't have space also many times to do this work. And then the 5 to 7 food groups to explain to them took us some time. So that was one of the problems. Then facilitation also without technical support, that was the issue. So the recommendations of whatever we have done in propagating this should be followed. And as a last step, I have brought Nutri Enterprises we have now stepped on to. I'm inviting you to Mahalakshmi Saras from 17 January to 29 January, where we have a Nutri Villa, which will show you the progress of what we have done from the beginning to the end till now. And we have now reached to 26 districts, 254 blocks, 7,000 plus villages. and 72,000 plus households, targeting SHG women, pregnant, lactating women, children below 2 years, adolescent girls. And basically, we have diversified diet, reduced dependence on medical aid because their health has improved, and also increased the capacity for livelihood because their lives are good. I'd like to end by a song which we have written for the women who are there, and which we use to motivate them. Suno sakhi kaam ki baat main batane aayi, poshan ka mahatva tumko samjhane aayi. Suno sakhi tumhe main baat ye batane aayi, poshan vatika ka mahatva samjhane aayi. सुनो सखी घर में सबकी सेहत ठीक हो बुजुर्ग बच्चे और परिवार चुस्त हो खाने में सब्जियों का महत्व समझाने आई सेहत का राज मैं तुमको बताने आई सुनो सखी थैंक यू वेरी मच
So I am presenting on behalf of the teams at IFPRI and also our collaborators at the World Bank both past and present on the experimental evidence of the impact of a pilot program called the Jivika Multisectoral Convergence or Jivika MC pilot, which was conducted in rural Bihar. So I just want to start by thanking everyone who's been involved in the project from the implementation and the evaluation side. So in terms of motivation, the status of nutritional indicators, particularly for mothers and children in India, is not particularly good. We have very high rates of both maternal and child undernutrition. When combined with our large population, we actually contribute a great deal to the global burden of stunting, of anemia amongst women and children. In addition to this, indicators have been really slow to move over the last decade. So if you look at the transition between NFHS 3, which was 2005-06, and NFHS 4 in 2016, we've actually not seen a kind of rate of change that we would expect to see or need to see in order to actually achieve our targets under the SDGs. And then a problem that is kind of pervasive in India, you have national level statistics that actually mask a lot of interstate and even intrastate heterogeneity. So you have some states that are performing well and some that are not, but even within well-performing states, you can have pockets of districts that are actually performing quite badly. So Bihar is one such example of a state that has not been performing particularly well. So in the graph on the left, what I have is just three indicators: the proportion of children who are stunted, proportion of women who are underweight and anemic, and Bihar is performing considerably worse than the All India average. So the question that the intervention and then the evaluation set out to answer is it possible to leverage the reach and potential of Jivika SAGs in order to accelerate the change in health and nutrition that we want to see in Bihar? And so we have a Jivika SAG platform. I have the figure up there of the reach of 8 million women, but someone just said that they reach now 10 million women. So we have a programmatic platform that has tremendous reach. It also has the potential to target a number of both underlying and immediate determinants of undernutrition. So can we leverage that platform to actually effect change? So what does the intervention look like? So at the top in the green boxes, we have the sort of standard or core Jivika interventions. So the first is organizing these women into SAGs and their higher level federations, so VOs and CLFs. And then as the groups mature through the provision of trainings, to provide them with bank linkages, to provide them with lines of credit, and also to provide them with access to Jivika funds, such as the Food Security Fund and the Health Risk Fund. In addition to this core standard model of Jivika, what this intervention proposed to do was add on two more components. The first component was to provide health and nutrition behavior change communication, or BCC, and this was provided through a dedicated agent, the community mobilizer. And for those of you who are not familiar with the Jivika model, the community mobilizer already exists in the system. She is the bookkeeper at the SAG level. The second component was what was known as the convergence and coordination component. So this component promoted increased awareness and utilization of government schemes, but also of the use of Jivika funds like the Food Security Fund, which were kind of aimed at improving food security and quality of diets. And so what our intervention is testing are the two additional components. I'll call them the BCC and the CNC components for the rest of the presentation. So in terms of design, our evaluation went to 24 gram panchayats in three blocks of one district of Bihar. It was a cluster randomized controlled trial. The cluster was at the gram panchayat level. And so these 24 gram panchayats were divided equally into treatment and comparison arms. And then we had two criteria for inclusion in our study. So women who had children between the ages of 6 and 24 months at baseline, and who belonged to households where at least one member was an SED member, either the woman herself or another family member, were eligible for inclusion. A full listing of all such women was conducted, and then a sample of women was selected at random. So what did our evaluation look like? I like that Yamini kind of set this up by talking about a process evaluation, so we have that up there. We had three waves of data collection, a baseline, a midterm process evaluation, and then the end line, covering slightly over 2,000 women and slightly over 2,500 children. So the main impact evaluation results that I'll turn to on the next slide come from the baseline and end line. We did a panel survey of women that spanned May 2016 to October 2018. And as part of this panel survey, we interviewed both male and female members of the household. We conducted community surveys at the village level, and we also interviewed the community mobilizers. Ultimately, the models that we used to assess impact were ANCOVA models, and I can talk more about those later. What's interesting, and I think one of the added components of our study that adds a lot of value, is that we did a midterm process evaluation. So we've been hearing a lot about process evaluations and having that process evaluation feedback into the intervention and actually provide learnings. So what we did was that 1 year into the intervention, when approximately a year or a year and a half was still remaining, we did a really comprehensive mixed methods process evaluation. So we collected quantitative data, but we also did a number of qualitative interviews, both by our team and by trained enumerators of Jivika staff, all the way from the state level down to the community coordinators. And then we also did additional interviews at SEGs and BO levels. And one thing that I think I've not seen a lot of being discussed, but maybe Biju Rao's presentation does something similar, is that we did SEG observations as well. So we actually had enumerators sit in SEGs and record how the SEG was, how the deliberations were continuing. So in terms of results, and I have just one slide on results, but I'm happy to talk more about this in the question and answers. So we had two primary outcomes. The first was women's anthropometry measured by BMI. The second was child dietary diversity. So we found no results on women's anthropometry between baseline and end line. And what I have up here are the kernel densities of women's BMI. To the left are the baseline curves, and to the right is the end line. If you can't see two curves in each of those sub-diagrams, that's kind of making the point. There is a dashed line that is the comparison arm. The solid line is a treatment arm, but the curves are almost overlapping. If anything, at end line, there's a slight increase in the density of women around the 18 kilograms per meter square mark, which is kind of the cutoff for normal weight, but none of this was significant when we looked at it in our regression models. We do, however, see a large impact on child dietary diversity. So we don't actually measure the proportion of children attaining minimum dietary diversity, because children who were 6 to 24 months at baseline were no longer within the age group for which that indicator is valid by the time end line came around. So instead, what I'm presenting here is just the number of food groups consumed by children. So we see a 7 to 8% increase in the number of food groups consumed by these kids. And all the changes that we see are coming from pulses, from fruits and vegetables. We don't see actually a big change in the proportion that are consuming flesh foods, and the proportion that are consuming eggs remains below 5%, both at baseline and end line. And we can talk about that when I come to the kind of the challenges with SEGs. We had a whole range of secondary outcomes. We were one of those people who were guilty of a multi-hour questionnaire which covered, you know, everything that you could possibly think of. Our key secondary outcome is women's dietary diversity. And we kind of see results in the women that mirror the results that we see in children. There's a 30% increase in the proportion of women attaining minimum dietary diversity. Much of the changes, again, come from pulses and fruits and vegetables, but also from dairy. We still don't see much consumption of flesh foods or eggs. We see a significant improvement in knowledge around diets and diet quality. both amongst the respondent women as well as amongst the community mobilizers. We also see some evidence that there was increased utilization of kitchen gardens and also Jivika funds for food. But we also investigated a lot of things around pathways. We find that there's no impact on standard SAG savings and credit activities. There's no impact on household food security. There's also, interestingly, no impact on women's empowerment, and this is measured both by decision-making as well as indicators of mobility. So the other thing that I think our study did that I have not heard anyone mention in the last 1.5 days is that we did a costing analysis. So we collected retrospective data on financial costs, not economic costs, and we used the activity-based costing ingredients, or the ABCI method, to actually analyze, to collect and to analyze those costs. So the first step of that is you identify mutually exclusive and exhaustive activity centers. So these are centers that are kind of representative of program activities. And those are the 6 that we had identified. And then once you have those activity centers, you then list the ingredients or the inputs that go into calculating each of those costs. And then we collected costs both from formal budgets of implementers as well as focus group discussions and key informant interviews. And in order to put those costs into some kind of perspective of a per beneficiary or per SAG, we also collected information on the total number of SAGs served, the women within those SAGs, target beneficiaries, and so on. So the total cost of implementation is up there. What we did find is that the BCC component accounted for almost 3/4 of the total cost, and the convergence and coordination component was a very small fraction, only about 5% of the total. This study did have a feasibility phase. If you look at the pie chart, you find that the feasibility phase accounted for 44% of the overall cost. So this is actually an artifact of the fact that the project only lasted for a little over 2 years. And of course, if you have a longer project, then that feasibility phase will become a smaller and smaller fraction of overall costs. And then if you look at unit costs, we have a per SAG number of about $148 per SAG. And a per SAG meeting number of about 2.75. This is if you exclude the feasibility costs. I know these numbers don't really make much sense, but the only other study, which is the caring trial that Nair et al. Have published recently, finds a per beneficiary annual average cost of about $7. When we look at our per SAG per meeting cost, it's about 27 cents, which comes to about $6.48 per year. So we're kind of in line with that. So I'll just quickly close with what we've learned. And this is coming both from this intervention as well as a broader body of work where we're working also with Pradhan in multiple states. So through the process evaluation, where tasks were tangible, there was a great deal of role clarity, both amongst Jivika staff at all levels. The content knowledge of both the CMs and the respondent women was actually higher around topics that are what I would call universal. So if you're targeting a nutrition intervention to an SAG, and many of the women in your SAG are past childbearing age, then information on complementary feeding, breastfeeding, et cetera, doesn't get retained as often. But stuff around diets, which is kind of universal across the life cycle, tends to be retained and remembered. Specific to this intervention, the BCC content was too generic, could not be traced really to this intervention, which made evaluation a problem. But also through our SAG observations, we found that health and nutrition was only about 10 to 15 minutes out of a 1.5 hour SAG meeting. So it seems that the amount of time that SAGs could dedicate to this was limited. More broadly, what we're finding about SAGs as a platform, and a lot of this has been mentioned, especially by Yamini, so I won't talk about this much. We know that they have significant potential to target a whole bunch of underlying and immediate determinants. And so there's a lot of scope and there's a lot of interest in using them to look also at health and nutrition. But there is a danger of overloading these platforms. And not just the platform, but also if you have one community cadre, there's a danger of overloading that. The reach is high, but the targeting is lower. So who are the women that we're reaching through the SAGs and what are the kinds of messages we're trying to send them? There's been a lot of criticism of using women's labor for free. So, this is a question out there about, is there any research on how incentivizing, whether that works better, so incentivizing the women or incentivizing the volunteers? And then finally, then this comes back to the point around eggs. Especially in diets and health and nutrition, social norms and taboos are often very hard to shift, and they're very hard to shift over a small period of time. And one of the things in which SHGs are actually failing, in my opinion, is that they are only targeting women. And so if you want to change things around norms about eating behaviors within the household, it's important to target grandmothers, it's important to target husbands. You can't just target the woman in isolation and expect that to help. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Vani. I work in the nutrition division in UNICEF, supporting Ministry of Health, WCD, Tribal Affairs, in delivering services to the community. 2012, we ventured out, very unlike the UNICEF nutrition section work, in moving our work with National Rural Livelihood Mission. I'd done it in my previous organization, USAID, with urban, but not with NRLM. Vijay Kumar and Vijay Anand, sir, were our mentors at that time when we started. Lakshmi is still sitting here, where we were moving across that merely training and training and training is not really helping. Step number one. Poorest of the poor is conducting counseling for and in home visits without being paid. It's unacceptable that the poorest of the poor is doing counseling and not getting paid. Why is counseling not a service? Why is it still a seva? At the same time, NRLM was struggling that livelihood interventions are not leading to improvement in nutrition and health outcomes. It was a good marriage. And Vijay Kumar sir made it really tough for me at that point. He made me travel across all 10 states, go talk to all women, ask them what they want, make a micro plan exercise, and then come back to me. We did that. And believe you me, since then, it's been a very fruitful journey. Let me ask you all a question. We all are a collective, aren't we? Correct? We think about the poorest of the poor. We are sitting here. Now slowly, we start dividing work amongst ourselves because we care. Okay? Then I start giving you targets. You have to do this, you have to do this, you have to do this, you have to do this. And I'm just gonna say, you're not gonna get paid for it, okay? You keep doing that for 2-3 years, you're gonna stop. And that's something which I would request each one of us that works with village organizations, CLFs, don't give them targets. They are people like us. If we cannot volunteer 2 days of our time for any activity, we have no business to be asking others to do it free of cost. Women's time is precious, and hence it should be incentivized. And that was the belief by which we started this work at UNICEF. That we start working for women, with women, and getting men slowly into the game. A lot of the work happens around 1,000 days. Okay, very sexy. Everyone wants to do it. Everyone likes to talk about the Lancet series. Has anyone talked about the first 500 days of the first 1,000 days? We don't. Most of the nutrition interventions are child-centric, food-centric, and start after birth. But your clients, the people that you work with, are women. Let me ask you a question. How many of us have ensured that the SHG women themselves have had a health checkup? That's a health intervention. They're coming for meetings. Unka khud ka health checkup jab tak nahi hoga. I'm sorry, I will talk in Hindi, English. How will they see, am I good, bad? How do I move ahead? And that's how we started our journey. Lots of brainstorming with Vijay Kumar sir and Vijay Anand sir. Neeta Kejriwal ma'am was there right from the beginning, that let's develop a micro plan for health, nutrition, water sanitation, and gender, just the way we do our CIF funds. When you do give your funds for CIF, everyone makes a plan, right? And then they get money to implement their plan. So why can't we have a nutrition investment fund where people, you only ask questions and people get funds to implement it based on the problems of their community, not based on your PLA trainings, which you've decided here and you want to do there, and you want to give it to the donors. Because trainings are not action. And I don't think NRLM is in the business of community training. We are in the business of community action. So I show you a video of 1.5 minute. I will show you a snapshot of another 1 minute and give you 5 tips and tricks which I have done firsthand in the field, integrating FNHW and gender into NRLM. We have been able to develop toolboxes, how to do it. You all were already doing a microcredit plan. How do you make FNHWG microplan? What is the method? And we came up with a simple method, char ka. Samasya kya hai? Karan kya hai? Karna kya hai? Budget kya hai? Dr. Rao just mentioned about qualitative methods. This is our qualitative method of identifying community problems and attaching a budget to it as a service cost, which is paid by the SRLMs to the village organizations to implement their own plan. This is unlike other programs where you're giving an individual cash transfer or using the poorest of the poor as a free voluntary force. Nutrition counseling is a service, it should be paid. Running a health camp is a service, it should be paid. What's new this program adds? And this is something that we negotiated with NRLM since a very long time. You're a gap-fill organization. Please don't make CRPs an Anganwadi worker, Asha worker. It is the job of an ASHA worker to conduct community meetings. Why is the CRP conducting the same community meetings using PLA? Participatory learning and action meetings without action and a budget is useless. People change behaviors by practice, which becomes their attitude, and that becomes knowledge. Knowledge, attitude, practice often doesn't work. In a snapshot, we tried this out in 3 states, nested an evaluation in 5 blocks, tried to study the effect of this intervention on women's outcomes. Guys, isn't it common sense that if a woman's nutrition status improves, the child's would? Do I need a randomized control trial to tell me that, or do I need a common sense trial to tell me that? How many of our nutrition interventions target outcomes on women? We don't. We commodify the woman to see the outcome on low birth weight. But what about her own nutrition status? And hence, the Swabhiman program tries to improve the nutrition status of girls, newlywed, pregnant and breastfeeding mothers, and study the effect of the intervention on their outcomes. You can see ripple effects on the child if you want to. It taps NRLM's platform to take care of the at nutrition risk women. You would, if whoever has worked with ICDS would know, bachcha jab kuposhit hota hai, usko hum identify karte hain, usko double ration dete hain. I have 2 minutes. But maa kuposhit hoti hai, na hi hum usse screen karte hain, aur na hi uske liye double ration dete hain, ya kuch bhi karte hain. Why can't NRLM just focus on at nutrition risk women? Because ICDS doesn't focus on that. Newlywed, they don't focus on, so you focus on that. Adolescent groups, they don't focus on. And 5 years back when we started on, NRLM clearly told me, we don't work with adolescent groups, please focus on women. I said, sir, give us a chance. Maybe after 5 years you do. And now, at least in Jivika, the CEO said they're going to now include adolescent groups and the PLA methods and giving them loans for secondary education as part of it. Broadly, Dashashutra was already there. We picked that up, ma'am, from Maharashtra. But what we were struggling was, main isko kaise karun? How will I do it as part of the NRLM CIF book, workbook? Why should I have a separate micro plan for FNHW? Why can't it be a part of the annual action plan and in a systematic way with the fund chapter as a community cash grant added, and that goes to them? So I remove all NGOs as part of the process, because NGOs, largely we have seen, they create models and everyone wants to just promote their models and models and models. Well, one thing doesn't work in the other community. And my fundamental question was, if you're really doing micro planning, why is in every village discussions only happening about complementary feeding? Well, that may not be the problem in that community. If in that village the problem is sanitation, that's the problem, that's the solution that should be taken. So under Swabhiman, they are allowed to implement only the top 3 solutions, and every quarter we are supposed to sit and see where are they with the micro plan. Kya samasya thi, karan kya tha, kiya kya tha, ab kya karna hai. And now in 5 years, in Chhattisgarh after that, what didis have said in Bastar is, aadmi logon ko nahi layenge, nahi hoga. To ab hum kar rahe, aadmi logon ko kaise lana hai, kya kya wo activities hain jo wo kar sakte hain, and we move ahead. We have all toolkits that are available, and one thing what we have seen is we have created institutional structures now to support this replication and learning, colleagues. One organization, one Vani, one Vinay here and there will not help. You need academic institutions supporting government programs. The beauty about Swabhiman is, colleagues, there is no international evaluator for this program. It is done by the local All India Institute of Medical Sciences in all these states, supported by a consultant. Local organizations, local institutions, capacity needs to be built to support ongoing research, otherwise it becomes very expensive. And this 4-curve micro-planning approach is nothing but a qualitative method for seeing change and feedback. We have our papers published for, you know, the satisfaction and consumption of all researchers, but we have also seen girls going back to school. We have seen child marriages being reduced. I have seen egg being eaten. It's enough for me. And most important, we have been able to proudly develop a tool hands-on with the didis of how to actually do it in the field of whether it is food, nutrition, health, water, sanitation, as a part of the annual action plan. And my request is, and that's my last word dear to everyone, you are right now making your annual action plans. Please don't do separate CRP rounds for FNHW and separate for your CIF. Just join it together, it saves everyone's time. Internal CRPs are available from Bihar, Orissa, Chhattisgarh. They can train you. Please do not give money to NGOs. There are community training centers in Bastar, in Bihar. The didis can come and support you. just the way you started your CIF approach in the first phase of NRLM, FNSW should be used with the same mandate. Otherwise, I'm afraid you will make them another Mithanin, you will make them another ASHA worker. Thank you very much.
So I'll start with the summary findings and then show you some evidence and definitions of what all of those mean. But in summary, health messages we've learned through self-help groups work in improving maternal, newborn, and child health and nutrition indicators. A greater program exposure, and I'll tell you what that definition means, is linked to increased uptake of those practices. Stronger groups lead to stronger and better improved health and nutrition and development outcomes broadly. The SHG platform can be utilized for integrating and layering on other programs, such as through the use of mobile phones that was discussed earlier as well. And increasing the capacities of the grassroots functionaries is very key to that programming, and that has also been touched on by my colleague Kalyani. So a nutrition pilot done in Bihar in 2018 and 2019 really showed improvement in breastfeeding and child dietary diversity, and some of the conversations early on really focusing on how easy it is to focus and program around child nutrition, and it's much more difficult to focus on maternal nutrition, was a hallmark learning for us, not just through the outcome evaluations we did, but also through the process evaluations and the conversations we had with implementing partners. And here it really comes to show how concerted programming does improve outcomes. Interventions that improve uptake of correct health practices. So when we were fortunate again to look at many different programmings and learned that the hallmark of behavior change communication also applies within self-help groups. So the more the women hear of the same messages over and over, not just through the same mediums, but through different mediums at different times by different people, they are more likely to take up the processes. We also found out that the very basic sentinel elements of a self-help group program, that is having health messaging integrated in health meetings or meetings that are held anyways weekly, as well as simple home visits by those who are at the grassroots, has a huge impact in retention of the knowledge as well as practice of those behaviors. And there has also been a cost-effective learning for programs as well. Rather than focusing on very complicated, expensive interventions, these very simple interventions, when done repeatedly by different people, actually has an impact on outcomes. And when we come to the third one, really, we were able to do an efficacy study of sorts within the district of Jammu, where women received health nutrition messages primarily through mobile phones. And over time, their ability to remember those messages as well as then to transfer those messages into behaviors increased. While this has a challenge of actual coverage, so we talked about a large reach but a limited target, this program really brought to light the issue around coverage and that there is still a lot of need for ground level functioning needed, ground level effort needed, even when the utilization of something so ubiquitous and something so handy like a mobile phone is the medium of the intervention. And then we also learned that stronger groups improve health and nutrition behavior. So rather than focus on all of the evidence, all of the numbers on the slides, I can just tell you when we look at strength of groups, they are what your sentinel indicators are around frequent meetings, regular savings, connections to banks, taking out loans. So basic functionalities of groups, as they sustain themselves, as they're more regular, also have an impact not just on improving economic outcomes, reducing economic vulnerability, but they also help sustain maternal and nutrition health outcomes. Again, reflecting the pathway where regular meetings lead to regular conversations and more collective support within the groups. So this is a very important element that needs to go hand in hand with all of the health and nutrition programming that happens. And lastly, the role of the grassroots functionaries. So we were fortunate again in Bihar to do a baseline assessment of the capacity building that had been ongoing of the community mobilizers, who are the women from the communities. They help support the groups. They have about 100 women that they're working with, that they're leading. They are the face of Jivika on the ground, and they're also women of the community, and so highly respected and regarded as a member of that community who can hear their voices and respond to their needs. when these women who had had no training on health and nutrition programming received very basic knowledge training on what messages are and then were asked to share those messages, their knowledge on health and nutrition went up. And there is a lot of qualitative work we were able to see as to how their confidence went up, how their status in their communities went up, as well as within Jivika, there was a lot of regard for them. The learnings from the evaluation also showed that these women really have finite time. So that's another point that has come up repeatedly and I'd like to bring up. So these women are spending about 4 hours a day, so between 11 a.m. and 3 p.m., as Yamini noted, doing this voluntary work that's rewarded with a very small honorarium. And within that time, they not only have to do all of the work to keep their group strong, that we described in the slide before, but they also have to do all of this health and nutrition programming. And besides being given just basic knowledge training, they haven't been given any other elements to support themselves. And so the evaluation has really brought a lot of insights into all of the other soft skills, the time management, the prioritization that is needed to accompany the basic training on health and nutrition programming for these grassroots functionaries who are doing an amazing job on the ground to continue their work. So this is really all I had. Thank you.